Welcome back. You're watching Newsmaker Live. I'm Kendall Boots, and my guest this evening is Mr. Christopher Alexander, the Director of Maritime Affairs at the St. Lucia and Seaports Authority. Of course, we're talking about maritime affairs. In terms of licensing, what are some of the procedures that are in place for persons who want to get licenses to ply? What are the requirements? What are some of the standards that SLASPA has set for them?
Kendall, that's a very good question. In terms of the plying for hire, the general manager of SLASPA under the Port Authority Act, he has the final say as to the issuance of a license to ply for hire or a license for boats to be engaged in commercial activity. Mm. So that's within the powers of the general manager of SLASPA. As the Director of Maritime Affairs, I do not have the jurisdiction to issue out licenses to ply for hire. Plying for hire, most of it emanates within a port of call or within a port. Mm-hmm. So hence that Port Authority Act, mm-hmm, and not the Shipping Act, gives the manager that power. And what we would do at Maritime, we would inspect the vessel first to ensure that the boat meets the requisite standards, mm-hmm, before it can be sent across to our general manager at SLASPA for him to, based on our advice, for him to issue out a license for him to be engaged in commercial activity. We also have
So it's basically WAC, up to one person?
No, we also have the WAC, or what's called the Watercraft Advisory Committee.
Okay.
And on what we've done, that's a entity of various stakeholders. You have the Ministry of Tourism, okay, you have the Director of Seaports, and they would sit on those applications and they would advise, mm-hmm, SLASPA as to the issuance of a license based on the other concerns that they may have about that application. But when it's done right now, then we would meet at SLASPA, and based on that recommendation, then you'd go ahead and issue the license to apply for.
When you say we at SLASPA, who are you referring to?
Well, the general manager. Under the law, mm-hmm, you have to have someone to sign off on to. So he would be the one to sign on the license to, mm-hmm, issue out to persons. So all boats that are carrying passengers, mm-hmm, in St. Lucia, mm-hmm, it's under the law, they must have a license to apply for hire or a license to be engaged in commercial activity. Mm-hmm. And we actually have a list of those vessels that we circulate to various establishments, including the Marine Police as well,
okay,
to ensure that those persons, they have the license before they can go and carry our guests, mm-hmm, to ensure that the boat is safe before it can leave our waters. So when they leave in the Castries Harbor, they are supposed to call the Vigil Lighthouse and give at least the number of persons they have on board, what time they'll be leaving, and what time they'll be returning to port. So there's you can track in terms of when those boats are going, mm-hmm, and when they're returning to port.
Yeah, but that information you said you shared with the Marine Police, and it brings to mind the issue of, you know, the public information and education component of what you do. How much of that information is accessible to the public? Granted, that most people who go on a boat ride or use vessels for whatever recreational or other commercial activity, may perhaps pay little attention to issues of that sort. For those persons who are interested in knowing whether the vessel they're going on is safe, is licensed, you know, where can we access information to say, well, this vessel is in fact, you know, a legal vessel?
Okay, Kendall, in terms of the vessels that are issued applying for our license, mm-hmm, what we've done at SLASPA, we issue those boats with a decal, mm-hmm, an orange decal, which, mm-hmm, it will be stuck on that vessel.
Right.
And it will list the amount of persons the boat is supposed to carry, mm-hmm, also the start date and the expiry date of that license that they have to apply for hire.
Mm-hmm.
So that sticker must be prominently displayed on board those vessels that are applying for hire.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of the listing of boats that are endorsed or licensed to apply for hire, I think that's an area maybe we can have those published in terms of through the SLASPA website.
Mm-hmm.
But as of now, it's been circulated to the various agencies, the various ministries, mm-hmm, or law enforcement. So again, that's an area again we can look to forward in terms of seeing if we can expand in terms of the information that the public can have a general, they can actually access that information. So, mm-hmm, that's an area I think we can revisit and take on board as well.
Yeah. While we be on the subject of boat rides, I want to talk a little bit about what some of the requirements are. What do you look for when you inspect a vessel? What are some of the standards that apply here? Can I understand there are different types of standards, if I can use that? Is that a correct term, standards?
Yes.
So in the case of, there was a recent incident where somebody fell off one of the vessels. Subsequent to that, we were told that a police investigation was launched and that individual was, in fact, according to eyewitness accounts, pushed over the vessel. While it doesn't bring into question the safety of the vessel overall, obviously this is an individual issue as far as I'm concerned, but what is CLASPA's role in terms of enforcing these standards, and what are the standards, first of all, that boats of that type have to adhere to and meet?
In terms of, we have the basic threshold of inspections,
right,
where we need to ask for the life jackets on board, and we ensure right. that if a boat has, for example, 80 persons on board,
mm-hmm.
we would ensure that they have a 10% increase in life jackets. So they would have to have 90 life jackets on board. So we actually make them carry more life jackets than the number of persons and the carrying capacity of the vessel. So we don't have a case wherein you have an incident and everybody's fighting for one jacket. So we have them put 10% increase as to what the carrying capacity is.
I did not know that. That's good to know.
Yes, and that's also important.
Mm-hmm.
And what we've done as well, for the larger vessels, we've also told them that they have to conduct once a month at least drills on board,
right.
A maneuver board drill on board, a fire drill on board, and it will be important going forward to show that the vessel actually was able to lower the risk by carrying out those mandatory emergency drills. So that's another area that we are actually enforcing with the assistance of our internal ports police and also the Coast Guard as well.
Right.
And moving forward as well, Burton, we've also ensured that the crew and the captain on board those vessels, that the captain is trained. So a few years ago, anybody could have gone behind the wheel of a vessel and dragged the vessel around the coastal waters of St. Lucia.
Right.
But for the past several years, the law is that you must be trained, you must be certified, you must have a license from CLASPA through the Maritime Division for you to be a captain of a vessel.
Right.
And we've informed all the hotels, all the areas that those boaters can get business from as to what the criteria is for those persons to be engaged in business with those entities. So they are aware of the requirements, and it's a matter of continuously updating persons and trying to expand the information out there. We are aware that sensitization is a continuous program.
Mm-hmm.
So we at CLASPA, we are continuing to sensitize the public. We have had, every year we try to at least have two national meetings where we bring all the boaters in and re-emphasize or re-educate them or discuss issues that concern them as to the maritime sector. That has worked quite well, but there's still work to be done to make them even more sensitized, because they're carrying our lifeblood, which is our tourists and
ministry,
our locals
right.
as well. So those boaters have the country's lifeblood in their hands.
Mm-hmm.
It's a matter of letting them know it's a business that they're engaged in. I say a small boat, like a small floating hotel. So I'm trying to show the boaters out there, they actually are a mini hotel. The boat is a mini hotel, and you have to meet certain standards that the country or the state has signed on to internationally. So that's been sinking in, and then we have had a drop in terms of casualties at sea. It's a good sign, but we're hoping to have a zero incident free maritime environment in St. Lucia.
Yeah. In terms of the standards, isn't there also issues of ratio in terms of security personnel to persons on board of guests and crew?
Right, good, Kendall. But again, what we did, Kendall, 2-3 years ago, even before the incident that you mentioned earlier on, as with the unfortunate incident on the boat ride, we produced a brochure, and we had almost 1,000 copies circulated, and it gave the clear guidelines as to what those owners of the boat as well as the captain. So the law tells you that both the owner of the vessel and the master, who is the person on the scene, they two, those two individuals, company or individual, they are responsible for the safety of the vessel when it's out operating.
Right.
And we've told them that they must have two police officers or security on board the vessel. So when you get the boat rides going out right now, part of the requirements is that they must have two policemen on board that vessel, separate and apart from the crew that the boat may have, but they must have two security persons on board that boat to ensure that a level of safety is maintained on that boat throughout the boat ride or throughout the voyage.
Is it required, first, I know that you were talking about the decal that has to be prominently displayed. I know there are safety regulations that also have to be prominently displayed. I've not been on too many boat rides, and like those that I have been on, I cannot remember. But is it a requirement now, just as with the airlines, that somebody on board, whether through a loudspeaker or other device, indicate what the safety procedures are in the case of an emergency?
Again, even the brochure that we produce, it says that even before the persons out there, even before the boat departs or it leaves alongside the pier, the master of the vessel have to ensure that a safety brief is given out to persons on board to say, okay, where the heads on board the vessels are, what would be the maneuverable procedure on board the vessel, and in terms of a fire, how to evacuate the ship. So that's part of the condition of the license that the general manager of SLASPA issues on behalf of the authority. So in that document, it would tell them, here are the conditions, here are the procedures, here are the protocols. And again, that's part of it as well. So they, if ever you go on a boat ride and you do not hear that being said, you can bring it up with the master and say, but master, I know that you were supposed to give a safety briefing. I'm still waiting for my safety briefing. So, but we also have to hold the boat masters out there accountable as well, because maritime will not be in every boat ride. So I'm saying that if we know what the requirements are as citizens or persons who utilize the maritime sector, then we can hold the persons accountable for their actions.
Yeah, but imagine if you are a regular boat rider, you probably, you know, dismiss these things because you take it for granted. You know, you've been on, it's similar to when you're traveling, you've heard it so many times, you know, you put plug in your earphones and you bury your face in a book and you don't pay attention. But let's move on. There's a situation that arose in the Castries Harbour a while back, I'm not sure of the time frame now, where a vessel sank. There was a subsequent oil spill. Moves were made to contain that spill. That vessel remains in the harbor months later. Why is that?
Well, the tug Dodgers Bank sank in the harbor, Castries Harbor, sometime in October. And as a result of that, there was a slight, there was an oil spill that emanated from the oils contained within that vessel. And SLASPA, through the activation of the Oil Spills Committee for the Fire Service, and myself being the chairman of the National Oil Spills Committee, we were able to control that oil spill to the satisfaction of most of the stakeholders, including our fisher folk as well. However, that boat, it's owned by one of our national.
I'm going to ask you to hold that thought. Let's take a commercial break with you for one. And when we come back, you can elaborate on the procedure that you've been engaged in so far to address the tug that's sunk in the Castries Harbour. You're watching Newsmaker Live. We'll be right back.